Please be seated. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. For I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of death. Because I live, you shall live also. Well, thank you all for coming this morning on what is turning out to be a beautiful sunny day, per Carolyn's request, I imagine. We're all missing Carolyn very much. She was a very bright spot in our church and in our lives, and of course in the lives of her family and all her friends. And yet, God is searching our hearts today that even through this pain, we still are able to find comfort and joyful memories of Carolyn, hope. And we're going to once again, in Carolyn's death, experience the good news of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And interesting, I don't think I've ever done a funeral on the day before Easter. And it's so wonderful because Jesus and I were talking and he said, yeah, it's all about me tomorrow, but give Carolyn Saturday. That's all her. And then Sunday it'll be all me again. Don't worry, so we're fine. So thank you again for being here. After the service, we want to invite, what we're going to do is we will all stand and sing the final hymn, and then I will take Carolyn's urn, and the family will follow me out to the columbarium. Please let us go first, and if you would like to come and join us for a very brief committal service, that's fine, or if you would like to just go downstairs, we'll be in the fellowship hall for the lunch afterwards in just a few minutes. So we're all glad you're here. Please stay for the lunch afterwards and make yourself at home. All right? Let's pray together. Eternal God, God of grace and God of glory, we thank you so much for the great company of all of those who have finished their course in faith and who now rest from their labor. And this morning, Lord, we remember quite a lot of folks in our lives. We name them in our hearts before you this day. Some passed away quite a long time ago, but we still feel very tenderly in our heart, and others are much more recent losses. But we especially, on this day, praise you for your very special child, Carolyn Wrapp, whom you have now taken to yourself. Grant peace to her soul, O Lord. And let perpetual light shine upon Carolyn now even more than before. And help us, the rest of us, so to believe where we have not yet seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with Carolyn and all of your saints into the joy of a home that you have made for us too, a home made not with hands, but eternal in the heavens. And we pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 348 in the hymnal. They're also broadcasting the lyrics up there. We're going to sing verses 1, 3, and 4 together. So let's stand and sing softly and tenderly, Jesus is Calling. See on the border.
fleeting, the moments are passing, passing from you and for me. Shadows are gathering, deathbeds are coming, coming for you and for me.
Please be seated. We've got a few folks who would like to say some words on Carolyn's behalf, and we've broken that up with a bell choir performance in the middle of those, but we're going to add one to the list. In addition to Lauren and David, we're going to let a very longtime family friend of Bob's, his name is Ron, he's also going to say a few words. So Lauren, please, and David, and then Ron, and then we'll hear from the bell choir.
Okay. I'm not sure about the microphone, so we'll. First, thank you all for being here to celebrate Carolyn's life. My name is Lauren, and I'm her daughter. my husband Kurt and I have been staying in Fort Collins recently, and on our way down to Lakewood on Wednesday, we stopped for coffee at Dutch Brothers. We were chatting with the young man at the window, and he asked me what advice I would give my 20-year-old self. And Kurt was kind, and he reframed the question to what advice would I give my 20-year-old son? And after a few moments, I replied, listen to your mom and try new things. During the last few months, it's occurred to me that throughout my life, my mom offered three pillars of advice, both directly and subtly. Try new things, be kind and thoughtful, and take care of yourself. Mom was dedicated to living each of these ideas every day in ways both big and small. Sorry. Mom was full of talent in so many ways, and one of the most amazing talents she had was her ability to learn new languages. I remember that every time there was an opportunity for her to travel, she would spend 3 to 6 months learning the language of that country. In addition to Spanish, French, and German, she taught herself Hawaiian, Italian, Portuguese, Greek, Mandarin, and Hebrew, and I'm probably forgetting some. With this in mind, I'd like to tell you about a word from Sanskrit namaste. And it roughly translates to the light in me sees the light in you. And that is everything about my mom that I love. Mom's religion was very important to her, believing with all her heart in God and the message of Jesus. She loved going to church and singing in the choir and the bell choir and all the study groups. And I appreciate all of you who shared this love of God with her. And just as she believed in the Creator's light being in her, she saw the same light in everyone else around her. And this drove her compassion and her curiosity. Her respect for those around her enabled her to socialize and be friends with people who don't see the world the same way she does. Her compassion drove her to help others and help them in very substantial ways, and her curiosity about others was the source of her love of travel and languages. And so as we say our goodbyes, let's remember the joy she brought into our lives, whether it was through her friendship, her sense of humor and creativity, her love of language and travel, or her unwavering faith. She left an indelible mark on all of us. And in the spirit of namaste, let us carry forward the light that she shared with us, extending compassion and understanding to those around us. Mom, your light will continue to shine in our hearts, and I hope we all find solace in the memories we shared with her and the love that will forever connect us. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you all for being here. I am David Klein, Carolyn's son, and I don't know, I hope to get through this well. I haven't practiced it very well because I've been thinking about what to say and all the things that my mom has given me throughout my life. Help me be a good man. It's just been so surreal the last few months. I just can't believe at times that she's gone. And forgive me, I've been called the strong silent type, so I'm a much better writer than I am a speaker. Yeah, I've been thinking over the last few years what life was going to be like without parents, and the great loss that I'll feel when I don't have that anchor in my life and just that rock, the parents that I can rely on and go back to for stability. But being as surreal as it has been, you know, the last few months have been no help to find an answer for that, about what it is, life after your parents have gone. All I can say is that looking back for clarity, all I can rely on is what is real. And what was real with my mom was the virtues that she instilled in me. And some of those I'd like to share with you here. One, Lori already talked about her creativity and her just her I want to say wild creativity, but she was just, she was so creative, and I think I got a little bit of that from her, or a little bit, yeah. So she really recognized the talent in me for drawing as a young boy, and I wish I did it more now, but she advocated for me to be in the Gifted and Talented program when I was young. And unfortunately, my mind was elsewhere, so I needed to get my grades up in order to do that, but I couldn't couldn't get there. But she saw in me a strong talent there. And she helped me in developing those skills, and I looked up to her and all the wild games and fun games that she created out of her mind. Some of those are on the pictures up there, like the Halloween puzzle. She was always making a puzzle for somebody for some occasion, whether it was graduation or a birthday or whatnot. She also tried to get me into music, which I eventually stuck to and started to pick up the guitar in my adulthood, so that's been a great love of mine. Started with the piano. She even tried to get me to dance, which is not one of my stronger qualities. I'm a little bit too stiff at times. But yeah, when she was doing hula dancing, I really liked watching her do that, and so I expressed some interest, and she got me into some classes, and I appreciate that. She definitely exposed me to those things. Another one of her virtues was perseverance and resourcefulness. When she divorced my dad, she refused to take alimony, and she went straight back to work teaching, going back to her education of home economics and helped teach the mentally disabled how to cook and clean and make meals for themselves. And so she's very giving in that respect. Once she got through that kind of initial period in which she also took, it wasn't until I became a social worker and understood the system and the government and all the resources that we have available to us that I reflected back on my youth, and I remember her coming home with a big block of cheese, and the government cheese is what we all think of, right? And she never let me or Lori, I don't think she ever let us know that she got those resources. And I think that's a bit of pride for her. But I only caught on to that as I was like 40, maybe. So anyway, she used those resources well. She had a lot of pride in herself. She picked herself up. She went back to school after the teaching part and got her, I think she had a degree in education. And then I remember her traveling back to Strasbourg every day for her teaching practicum and always making sure that we were taken care of while she was out making that commute every morning. She also instilled in me compassion through her unconditional love. As we've said, she loved the people that she came in contact with. She wanted to know things about them and this earth that we happen to be born into. She loved to travel. She was a host parent for many people from around the world, for students, for families from other countries. She always enjoyed learning new things, learning new cultures, sharing with others. And but also the unconditional love that I felt from her. I always felt safe and accepted in her house. I could always go back there and know that I would not be judged for any sort of error that I might have made as a young man growing up. She was always there for me, and she also, I remember at one point, it was one of the defining moments of my life as a seventh grader. I got very depressed, and it was like a week long of rain in Colorado, which was just too much for me, just a solid week of rain that really just drew the weight of everything down. And so I remember coming up to my room as I had left the dinner table and said something that triggered something profound that triggered her to come up and speak with me. But she, without her reflection, she just really helped me get beyond that and into a space where I could see a better future. And so all these things and more made her a wonderful person and a mom that a boy and a young man could ever need to face the world and both then and now that she has moved on. And a friend of mine wrote me a letter after she had passed and let me know about the relationship that a son has with their mother. And he put it in a really succinct and profound way. He said that, you know, after your mom passes, a mother to a son holds a rooting stability. And it's when we lose our mothers as sons that can be shaken up to its core. And so how do we move on, and how do we go on? And I just feel that those values and those virtues that she instilled in me, she did a wonderful job. I can't thank her enough for those virtues and for helping me be a stable adult. And she was just great. She will greatly be missed. So thank you so much.
I have a little preparations here so I can get through this. I didn't bring a bulletin up here because as soon as I saw Carolyn's picture, I started to cry. We probably have all heard that old adage, real men don't cry. I want you to know that's straight from the pit. Real men do cry. My name is Ronald McCrary. My first wife was Joni, and we knew Bob and Carolyn at Our Savior's Reformed Church for somewhere around 20, 25 years, maybe 30 years over there. And about 20 years ago, Joni and I moved to Oregon after I retired from the state of Colorado. So I was trying to think through what I would like to say about Carolyn. I'm remarried again. My new wife is with me, Gladys. We haven't been married that long. When I signed the register, I signed it Ron and Joni and Gladys. Joni and Carolyn are already together. Okay. Start out by, you know, really, Carolyn, what a sweet soul and a real sweet friend. What I remember best about Carolyn is her willingness to help no matter what the problem or the dilemma was that you have gotten yourself into. It didn't matter how big that dilemma was or how small it was. She was always there with advice. And I use two items as examples. One is if you were putting a party together and you were at a loss for what to do in the party, Carolyn would have at least a couple dozen ideas. And her parties were fantastic. Now, that's kind of on the small end of importance. What do you do with a child that's been abandoned in the US? Very simple. Carolyn's solution was adopt her. And that's what she did. So she was what I would call a yes person. She, if you had a problem, she was there to help you. Her and Joni, Joni's maiden name was Klein also. It happened to be spelled with a C, but you know, who knows what it was way back when. When Joni and I moved to Oregon, it wasn't long before Bob and Carolyn showed up on our doorstep and basically said, "What can we do to help?" That's just the kind of people they are. Now, we all know Bob. Now, to be kind to him, he likes to be thought of as being a crumb bum. You know what a crumb bum is? That's Bob. But it's fake. Let me tell you, the last day that I lived in Colorado, I had sold my house, and the buyer came through for an inspection. And they got a ladder and they crawled up on the roof and they saw that the gutters had not been cleaned. And that was one of the things I said I was going to do, was clean those gutters. Well, I had given away all my good ladders and I had this old rickety stepladder, and I could get up on my roof with that, but I couldn't get down with that. If I touched it, it would be gone. It would just fly away. Fortunately, I had my cell phone with me that I just purchased. So I called up Bob. "Hey, Bob, what are you doing?" I said, "Can you come over and help hold my ladder for me while I get down off my roof?" Pretty soon, there he was. Came over and held that ladder so I could crawl off the roof after blowing all the debris out of the gutters. But Carolyn and Bob are really great people. So when I think of Carolyn, I'm always reminded of this one party she put on. And I'm gonna have to take a drink. You came in to their house, and she had an instruction sheet, and she had about 50, either they were safety pins or maybe they were paper clips strung together. Everybody started out with 50 of the same item. And before you knew it, before you could even read the instructions, people were up there asking you questions. And if you happened to use a particular kind of a word, and I don't remember what it was, it may have been a noun or a preposition, who knows. I probably passed the third grade of English, and after that I was lost. But these people just kind of swarmed around you. They were going to get your safety pins or whatever it was. And I think I got all the way down to one before I could figure out how this thing worked. And so I started getting them from other people by making them say the words that they didn't want to say. But that was her way of having this party. It was really fun. So anyway, that's basically all I have to say about Carolyn and Bob. Praise the Lord. I know Carolyn knew Jesus as her Savior. She was a really great friend to everybody. Thank you very much.
And finally, we'd like to invite Alicia and then Mary Ann to follow to come and share with us, please.
I'm Mary Ann. This is Alicia. I've known Carolyn for a long time, and I just found out her middle name is Maria. I never know that before. It's a lovely name. Carolyn was the smartest, most creative person I ever met, as people have spoken about that today. We became friends when Jim and I joined the fellowship committee at Our Savior's Church. Carolyn was the leader. This was happened about 40 years ago, so we've been friends a long, long time. As the leader, we all joined her. We brainstormed monthly activities like talent night, Hawaiian luau, pig roast, scavenger hunt with the clues in all languages, Thanksgiving dinner, even a 90th birthday party for three church members. But this was the perfect job for Carolyn with all her creativity and ideas and crazy things. She usually had Bob draping strings across the ceiling, and then Bob would be his stepladder, and hang all those things. Every one of these things that happened at Our Savior's Church had all these funny decorations on them. She was just so full of ideas and life. The Bible says there's a friend who sticks closer than a brother, although in my case it's a sister, my Denver sister. During Jim's bout with cancer, Carolyn and Bob were always there for me at the surgeries, at the hospital, and then afterwards, sleeping over, encouraging me, inviting me to their home, and just being a friend. Carolyn had a way of talking me into wanting to do things. The one that sticks out the most was hosting Morten Ellefsen, the foreign exchange student from Oslo, Norway. You know, it turned out to be the great experience for me and my family. We learned about Morten, his family, and Oslo, and all their customs. And Michael, they were juniors in high school. He went back to Norway to visit Morten that summer. The other big thing in our life with Carolyn and Bob was Jim and I enjoyed traveling to Puerto Vallarta with the Wrapps. Carolyn was the ever-present teacher, teaching us Spanish and all the words, all about the culture. She loved telling us about the baby turtles that hatched on the beach and near the condominium, and then we watched as they returned to the sea. We discovered that Carol Pearson and myself, the three of us, were about weeks apart in age. We celebrated our 70th and 75th birthdays in Mexico. We were looking forward to our 80th, which wasn't to be. I know for certain that one day we three amigos will celebrate forever. In eternity. Beautiful Carolyn, I love you and I miss you.
Go ahead. Sorry. She was a great teacher. For a curious child, I think that's awesome. I could ask her anything, everything. She always had an answer, Now, if I have to ask Dad, he tells me, look for the answer on Google. So, I just wanted to share with you what I wrote the day after Mom passed on December 1st. On November 30th, we were at Lutheran Hospital. Mom was in the bed. And we were giving her, we had a towel because she was hot. So we could be just comforting her. So the next day, we found out that she had passed. And my birthday was December 2nd, but long story. I won't go into that. But I wrote something for Mom on Saturday, December 2nd. So I want to read it. Today is my birthday and my gift. My gift is all the love and all the beautiful light and wisdom memories, lifetime memories you shared with me. I will celebrate knowing you will always be a part of me. I carry you with me today, Mom, on every day. The gift you bestowed upon me. It was May 26, 1999. I met Mom Carolyn, Miss Wrapp. She was my teacher, my eighth grade science bilingual teacher. I hardly spoke English. She would speak to me in Spanish. A few months later, I was hospitalized for wanting to end my life. And she came to visit me almost every day, bringing me homework from all the teachers. Every day. And sometimes she would tutor me. She spent time there at the hospital with me. One particular time, though, she brought a little gift and a little bag that she gave to me. It meant the world. It was a little makeup bag and a little puzzle ring that she had since a teenager when she lived with her dad and mom in Argentina. She showed me how to put it together. That day, my caseworker saw a difference in me when she visited me at the hospital. She knew something was different. I told her about this teacher. Needless to say, my caseworker went to the school where my teacher was working and asked her if she would be interested in becoming my mom, my foster parents. She told her that she would ask Dad and the church and pray about it. Then I started getting all these greeting cards from people at the church. It was incredible, all this love. I remember your beautiful smile that lit up your classroom. Plants everywhere. I can see it clearly in my mind that day I drive at your home, driving through the highway with excitement and fear, and arriving at your front door. Beautiful flowers everywhere and outside irises. And inside the house, I knew I was home. I often daydreamed when I was little that I would have a mom and a dad and a home and teddy bears. In the guest room, there's two teddy bears, just like I used to dream when I was little, which is crazy. But for real. My dream came true. My mom provided all that. And she taught me unconditional love. David, you talked about that, unconditional love. She always gave of her time and her kindness. She was an angel for me. I asked her on the 30th, what would you like? What is your request of me? And she said, just water the flowers. Twice a week. So I've been doing that. And they're blooming so beautiful. And I see her, I feel her in them. Thank you.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock, in whom I trust.
And God will raise you up on eagle's wings.
Capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings, your refuge, his faithfulness, your shield.
Sure.
nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come.
And God will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the star, and hold you in the palm of his hand.
For to his angels he's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. I was, I'm always aware of my 65-year-old eyes that don't work so good when the light is dim. So when we began that song and they dim the lights, I panic just surged in me for a moment until the light shone beautifully here and I could see perfectly. This will feature in just a moment in this sermon, the light. Several of you made mention of the light. Namaste, the light. So I have two scripture readings. The first is from just the plain old Revised Standard Version. It's from John's Gospel, chapter 8, verse 12. And this is Jesus talking to his disciples. He says, again, therefore, Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. And whoever follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. And then the second one is from the Message Translation, which is a more contemporary wording. And this is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, verses 17 and 18 in chapter 3. When God is personally present, a living spirit, that old constricting legislation is recognized as obsolete. We're free of it. All of us. Nothing between us and God, our faces shining with the brightness of God's face. And so we are transfigured, much like the Messiah, our lives gradually becoming brighter and more beautiful as God enters our lives and we become like God. There are two things of fundamental importance to Christian discipleship. Anyone who wishes to walk in the way of Jesus, it's not an exhaustive list, but anyone who chooses to follow Jesus, these two things are at the very heart of what it means to be a Christian, to live fully as a Christian. Number one, of course, is forgiving love. Jesus was pretty big on that, forgiving love. And number two is faith. And by faith, I don't mean a belief in something, you know, like a theological idea, for example, but rather as a trust in someone. And for Christians, this is God, who we believe was also revealed in Jesus. So in John's gospel, Jesus uses the metaphor of walking in the light, which then is echoed by Paul in his second letter to a Christian community in ancient Corinth, Greece. And yet when I say that, a metaphor is really an offering of a quality of one thing, like the riches of gold, for example, to convey the meaning of another thing, like generosity and kindness. So we say, she has a heart of gold. It's a metaphor, which of course Carolyn had a heart of gold, but we'll get to her in a second. The thing is, though, friends, I don't think either Jesus or Paul intended this living in the light image to be understood as a metaphor only. But I believe they were also offering us and the world an invitation to actually live in the light and with the light of Christ, not floundering around in the darkness, which its original Greek definition conveyed. The darkness, in addition to literal darkness, means also spiritual obscurity. And so to live in the light, then, is to be spiritually illuminated in communion with the light of God, the kind of existence that a follower of Jesus may expect. Although that word in the original Greek also conveyed more of an accompanying alongside of Jesus. So we're not following Jesus so much as Jesus puts his arm around us and says, walk with me, and I'll guide us together. Or the very interesting definition, I think, what it literally means is to walk in the way of. So in addition to the practice of forgiving love, I think faith, this trust in God, is what exemplifies the truest, highest form of Christian character. And frankly, this faith, this trust of God, is something, is a particular Christian behavior that I preach better than I practice sometimes, maybe often. I preach this better than I practice it, but Carolyn Wrapp was the exact opposite. She was, to use a very famous expression from Dr. Albert Schweitzer, Carolyn was a sermon walking. You know, meaning that her practice of unwavering, unconditional trust in God preached the gospel without Carolyn having to say a word. She preached it. It was revealed in the ears of Carolyn that listened patiently and without any kind of judgment to anyone who was in pain. And it was the gospel that was revealed in her eyes that always gave you the attention that you needed, even if you were at the Academy Awards in a room full of celebrities. Carolyn so walked in the light, and not just metaphorically, but actually, that her whole face actually shone like a Jesus tan. And it's interesting to hear the family and friends talk about that very thing. Did you hear that come up often? The light in Carolyn. So that's the immediate thing I noticed the morning, Alicia was talking about this, the morning that I got word that Carolyn had passed, and so I went immediately, and there was Bob and Lauren and Alicia present. They were present at her leaving that early morning. And when I walked into that room, the immediate thing I noticed, like I've never seen in anyone before, and I'm serious about this, was that the light had left her material body. And so it significantly affected the countenance of Carolyn more than I've ever seen. When I looked at her face, I almost didn't recognize her. Now, I'm a bit of a spiritual gumbo of light and darkness all mixed up myself. I'll just be honest. But Carolyn was all light. She and God's light were so fully fused together that when That light passed on from Carolyn's body. What remained in its absence was no longer Carolyn at all, or at least the Carolyn that we knew, but simply a now lifeless body. And that, of course, was one of the reasons why it was so absolutely different in appearance than before when she was alive. Faith, trust in God. Carolyn, that was part and parcel of Carolyn, as well as its companion, that other necessary Christian practice of forgiving love, healing love, generous love. For Christians, the love of God revealed in Jesus, crucified, and tomorrow we will celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. Carolyn had a very large love, a love that Carolyn loved Bob with, knowing that so many of Bob's political ideas were so misguided, but it didn't matter to Carolyn because the love was right. The love was on the right track. She and Bob were a team. They took care of each other. Hey, listen, Ron is right. Don't let Bob fool you. He's no crumb bum. He took care of Carolyn just as much as Carolyn took care of him. They were a team, love given and received. If I had to choose one word to define their marriage, I would say fun. I told Bob that. They had fun together. They had a joyful life. They traveled all over the world. They were best friends, which research shows is the number one component in a healthy, successful, long-term marriage. It's not romance and eroticism and all the stuff that is wonderful at the first, but over the long haul, the number one thing is if you enjoy one another's company and you're friends. And boy, they were. They were. And Carolyn's family, all the children and the grandchildren, and she was light and laughter to you too, for sure. And she loved you, and she was proud of you all, and she shared your accomplishments with us often. We got sick of hearing about you, son. But often. And it's so nice to see you now and make a connection with your face. We here at church loved her too, did we not? Choir, Bell Choir, the UW of Faith. They used to be called the United Methodist Women, but the UW of Faith, the study groups. Oh, gosh. Carolyn had herself in every part of this church, and we miss her here so much. And I've been, you know, it was interesting, the next few days after Carolyn passed, I kept checking the light bulbs around here because the light was dimmer. But of course, it wasn't the light bulbs. And I bet the family maybe has had an experience at their homes like this too. It wasn't the light bulb. It was that Carolyn's light had passed. So here's what I want you all to remember, something that we all already know, but we just need to hear it again from time to time. And I want to work off a theme that the great American poet from the 19th century, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, once used in a poem that he entitled The Rainy Day. And he compares his life, and he suffered a lot of personal tragedy, did Longfellow. But he compared his life to a cold, dark, and dreary day. And you've had days like that when it might not literally be raining, but because of grief or other kinds of things, life to you has lost at least temporarily its light. It's a cold, dark, dreary day. But he says in the final stanza, he suddenly cries and just changes course from all this, and he says, "Be still, sad heart, and cease repining, for behind the clouds is the sun still shining. Thy fate is the common fate of all. Into each life some rain must fall. Some days must be dark and dreary." Now, I think the genius here is in several layers. It's first of all an honest acknowledgement of the existence of suffering. Our Buddhist friends are much better about this than we are, but you know, what life does not know suffering at some point, sometimes many points. It's inevitable. So acknowledge it, honestly. You can't get through life without some suffering. but also the further wisdom of knowing its inevitability to even get to an acceptance of its value. And that's really going deep. Its proper place. In the natural earth needs watering. It needs rain from time to time. If all it got was sunlight, it would scorch and die. And we are of the earth, brothers and sisters. Genesis says we literally were created from the earth. And so it's the same with us. Into each life, some rain must fall, but we need it to fall. It's a necessary complement to the sunlight, which we also need to live. And so thus seen, life becomes things that always are happening for us rather than to us. We may feel that life is happening to us, but seen in this way, life is really always happening for us, even the rainy days, maybe especially the rainy days. But the part I want to draw attention to is Longfellow's insistence that behind the clouds, the sun is still shining. Never stopped. It's still shining. Whatever darkness is upon you right now, my brothers and sisters, days of late, perhaps grown cold, dark, dreary, whatever's going on in your life, the light is still shining behind the clouds. It hasn't gone anywhere, and it's the light and not the clouds that will ultimately endure. The clouds never last. They finally do pass. But the light shines through. So Carolyn's light has only left her body. But it's still shining. It still exists in full union now with the larger light of God. That same light revealed and shared in Jesus. So be still, sad hearts, and cease repining, because the clouds behind those clouds of our grief, the sunlight of Carolyn is still shining and always will be.
Thank you.
Test, there it is. Just a reminder that after the service, please allow myself and the family to go right outside, right around the corner, family, and you're welcome to join us, or you can go downstairs and begin lunch, and we will be out there just for a few minutes for the internment service. Our final hymn this morning is the joyful Swing Low, Sweet Chariot. So after our closing prayers, we're going to stand and sing. It's number 703 in the hymnals, all four verses. But will you join me, please, as we close the service in prayer? God of love, we thank you for all the happiness with which you have blessed us, even to this day, for the gift of life, and for home and friends, for travel, for health and strength, for creative work and nature and beauty, for our baptism and place in your church with all who have faithfully lived and died. We thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs and who died our death and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us always. For God, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. So we pray to you for one another in our need today, wherever they are, with everyone, everywhere who mourns with us this day. To those who doubt, Lord, give light. To those who are weak, give your strength. To all who have transgressed, who have erred, give your mercy, O Lord, and to us who sorrow, give your peace and even joy. Keep true in us the love with which we hold each other and the love that Carolyn shared so generously with us, for in all our ways we trust you. And to you, with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory now and always. Amen. Let's stand and sing together now, Swing Low, Sweet Chariot.
Sometimes down, coming for to carry me home, but still my soul feels heavenly bound, coming for to carry me home. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. The brightest day that I can say, coming for to carry me home, when Jesus washed my sins away, coming for to carry me home. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home.
Brothers and sisters, go in peace. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Creator, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be yours this day and always. Amen.